Good morning. Welcome, and welcome to all of you who are worshiping with us online. I'm Pastor Phil. If you'd like to talk about anything related to All Saints or Jesus, catch me after the service. I'd love to talk to you. It's not often that you'll hear Lennon quoted from a PCA pulpit, but I'm going to do it this morning because I think it's pertinent. He wrote, "There are decades where nothing happens. And there are weeks when decades happen." This has been one of those weeks. Our 20-year war in Afghanistan is ending in massive bloodshed, and might well get worse within this week. Inflation is on pace to set records. Buying a home is out of the reach of all but the most affluent people. Talk to anyone who's come to Boise in the last couple of months. Refugees from virtually every underdeveloped country in the world are seeking refuge here. While we struggle to deal with the homeless among us, things as seemingly straightforward as vaccines and masks used to be simple. They've divided families and states and even nations. We are on the brink of a possible war if China invades Taiwan. I read yesterday there's now an 11-item coronavirus pandemic anxiety scale called the CPAS 11. which measures symptoms of anxiety related to COVID-19. Because there's a pandemic also of anxiety. Can you relate? This morning, I read there's a Category 4 hurricane bearing down on the Louisiana coast, Hurricane Ida, where the hospitals are already full. And on and on. Nothing about this world is right, is it? Nothing about this world is as it should be. As Moltmann wrote, Jürgen Moltmann, the theologian on the cover, Christ was all about turning an upside-down world right side up. What was natural to him was unnatural to the world, foreign. But if, just if, his resurrection is true, and our resurrection with Christ is so sure as virtually to have already happened, then we are to live in the constant consciousness that we are citizens of another age. We are to set our minds much on that age. We are not to be conformed to this age, as hard as that is. That we are to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And that renewing means being conformed or changed or transformed to the newness of the age to come, which is already here. Because God says, "Behold, I make all things new." Please stand for our call to worship. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Please pray with me. O Lord, we weep with those who weep and mourn with those who mourn. Comfort these dads, these moms, these children and spouses who lost their brave service members in Afghanistan this week. As only you can, you've collected all their tears in a bottle. Help them feel your strong presence, see your tender hand all around them, and hear your voice directing them in these dark circumstances. Draw them daily to your word to process their pain and grieve with hope. Spur the body of Christ around them to be your hands and feet and to meet their practical needs. Thank you, Lord, that you are the defender of widows and the father to the fatherless. Bind up their wounds and heal their broken hearts. You alone are good, and you do good. And we pray that even their pain, that they will see your goodness in sustaining them through pain. Restore to them the joy of your salvation and sing over them and us a new song. Amen. Please remain standing. Please be seated. We come now to the time of our service where we have what's called a confession of sin. Every once in a while, someone asks you, why do we do a corporate confession of sin? So for all of you who have that question out there, this is why we do it. The corporate confession of sin has been a staple of the gathered church for centuries. If we lose our ability to confess corporately, that is, as a group, we run the risk of assuming that the Christian life is one of individualism, and it's not. Corporate confession is a rhythm that draws us back week after week into the humility and holiness. Without which no one will see Jesus. Most importantly, corporate confession provides opportunities to embrace the breathtaking realities of the gospel and of the assurance that it gives. When we confess our sins corporately, we build up the unity of our mutual need. We need each other. We all have guilt before God. We all have the stain of sin in our hearts. But corporate confession helps to build up the unity of our mutual solution. We confess as Christians knowing that we are forgiven. Amen. If you're able, please kneel with me for our confession. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All too easy. Father, thank you for loving us and accepting us and forgiving us as your children. Please accept our humble confession, Lord. Today we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please stand. Receive the assurance of pardon. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Is
Please be seated. We come now in the time of our service that we call the offering, which is in and of itself an act of worship. I'd like to say personally, thank you, church, for being so faithful during this pandemic, for however long it goes on. Thank you for giving faithfully and sacrificially. We know it's not been easy on anyone. And I'd also remind you that when you give to All Saints, you're not giving just to the operations of this church, but you're giving for the international outreach that we have and our support for missionaries abroad, for ministries here in this country, the Native American ministry that we support, many others. If you'd like to give, there's a box at the back. You can put a check or cash in. You can text to this number in your bulletin, or you can go to our website where it says give and click on that.
Good morning. My name is Lindsay Jacobs. Our family relocated from California a year ago this week. We survived our first year here. We've been members at All Saints since January. Each Sunday, we pause for just a moment to pray intentionally for our world and for our church. Today, we will be praying for our women's ministry as we begin an ongoing service project for the Shaner family. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise you this morning for your faithful love and provision. As we reflect on your faithfulness and generosity to the Shaner family, we can't help but remember our own stories. I praise you, God, for how you have used the suffering Joseph and I have endured through our family's cancer and infertility journeys to deepen our faith and trust in you and to minister to others in our lives who are suffering. Lord, we thank you today for how you are continuously protecting Rob. With each hospital visit, you faithfully provide new solutions for the problems that arise. Thank you for quickly answering our prayers for Rob's upcoming liver transfer. Thank you for how you are faithfully providing for the Shaner's financial needs, for Kathy's teaching position, and the healthy social outlet she will have as she continues to faithfully love and serve Rob daily. We want to especially thank you for our session and deacons who continue to pour out their love to the Shaner family in word and deed. Thank you, Lord, for Jim Winkle and Warren Bean, who have faithfully shown up to mow the Shaner's lawn, help with home maintenance, and even taking Rob to his doctor's appointments. We thank you for our strong leaders who faithfully model what it looks like to lay down their lives for others. Lord, we confess that we don't always keep the Shaners at the forefront of our minds. We don't always know the right thing to do or say when we see our brothers and sisters suffering. We confess that our lives are often so full that we don't have the time we need to love others as you have called us to love them. Lord, we ask you that you would bless the women of All Saints as we begin an ongoing service project for the Shaner family. We pray that you would use our service together to deepen our friendships with one another, and that we all would experience the peace, joy, and purpose that comes from living sacrificial lives. We pray that this service project would inspire each of us to take personal and proactive steps towards helping the Shaner family in some way. Whether it be volunteering for the upcoming service project, sending a note or text of encouragement, gift cards for groceries, a visit to their home to just hang out with them, or even just a hug, would you empower us to lay down our lives for Kathy and Rob so that they would feel encouraged and sustained, and that your name would be glorified as a result? We pray all of this in your most precious name. Amen.
God has given us peace. We were able to extend that peace to each other. So let's stand and greet each other with the peace of Christ.
Good morning. I said, oh. Good morning. Ooh. My name is Karen Woods, and my husband Shelton and I have been members of All Saints for over 20 years. Today's sermon is based on our text from St. Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 6, verses 1 to 6. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. If anyone thinks they are something when they are not, they deceive themselves. Each one should test their own actions. Then they can take pride in themselves alone without comparing themselves to someone else. For each one should carry their own load. Nevertheless, the one who receives instruction in the word should share all good things with their instructor. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. It's nice to see all of you this morning. Before I open up God's word, I want to thank all of those that have spoken over the summer. Will and Phil and Rhoda celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary yesterday. So congratulations for 50 years. Jeff Franzi and Joe Gerber. Next week, our interim pastor gets here. And the truth is, if somebody would have asked me, who would you like as your interim pastor for the next year, out of everybody in the whole world, it would have come down to two people. It would have come down to Rob Rayburn, who was with us for a month this summer and who will be back with us occasionally, and then Mike Kelly. And Mike Kelly is going to be our interim pastor, and he's going to start a series for the fall next week on the gospel according to Joseph, going through Joseph's life in the book of Genesis. Time flies. It just seems 13 weeks ago we were opening up the book of Galatians, and here we are. This is our last sermon from the book of Galatians. And remember that this is probably the first book written in the New Testament, and it was written to an embryonic church, the first Asian church in Christianity. And this book is arguably one of the most important books in Western civilization. You remember that Augustinian monk, Martin Luther, he married a woman, and they had a nice marriage. Her name was Katharina. And Martin Luther said that in the Bible, Galatians is my Katharina. The Wesley brothers and the beginning of the Great Awakening happened when they heard just the introduction of Galatians, the commentary by Luther. They heard that and they wrote that our hearts were strangely warmed by this. And now we come to the home stretch, chapter 6. And he basically says something like this: you've been starting on a journey, and on the journey, there's some things that you need to know. And so much of these verses are about the realistic aspect of the Christian experience. He begins by talking about what happens if you're caught in sin. And then he says, be careful that you don't fall into that same sin. And then he says, bear each other's burdens. He assumes difficulties. Be careful if you go to a church or there's a cult that says, take this pill, follow this rule, and everything will be okay. Because what the gospel says is, here is a new life that makes you ready for the streams of sorrow that are going to follow you the rest of your life. And we saw last Sunday that only Christ can redeem the hard things in our lives, these burdens that we have to carry. But there are so many things in these first six verses to look at that I've decided to look at just one thing, one command. And it's actually found, if you could look again, in verse number 1. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. There are really some surprising things that come from this verse that you don't see by just reading it in English. Beginning with the idea of being caught in sin, the term being caught in sin probably doesn't mean what you think that it does. We might think that somebody who is caught in sin is that they're sneaking around and they get caught, or they're stealing and somebody comes in and turns on the light and they're caught, or there's an alcoholic, he drinks too much, and they've been hiding a bottle, and it's found out, and so they're caught in that. A spouse is caught in unfaithfulness. And many stories in our day, because of the new technologies, talk about people, big stars, who are caught because of technology, right? Texts. Ah, I saw that text. Oh, I saw that website that you visited. I saw that email that you sent. And so we think of people getting caught that way. We say they got caught. But that's not what Paul is speaking here about. What he means here is if someone is unaware that they are ensnared by a particular sin, they don't know it. They don't know it. Most people who drink too much, you shouldn't have that third glass, fourth glass, fifth glass of wine. Most people who drink too much pretty much know, you know what, I probably drink too much. Most people who violate their consciences, they know usually that they are doing something wrong. But what Paul is talking about here is when somebody is ensnared by something that they don't even know that they're ensnared by it. I am a Chinese historian, and at the beginning of the 20th century, China was not doing very well. This great civilization of 5,000 years was basically the sick man of the world. War after war they lost. And one of the philosophers in China at the beginning of the 20th century was a great writer named Lu Xun. And Lu Xun says, this is kind of how I see China. It's like this parable, that there's a whole bunch of people and they're sleeping in this iron room. And one of them wakes up, and they walk around the room and they find out that there's actually absolutely no way to get out, and there's no oxygen coming in. And so the dilemma is, should I just let all these people sleep and die slowly, or should I wake them up to tell them, hey, we're all going to die because we're in this iron box and there's no way out? And he decides, well, the best thing to do is just let people go on and sleep. Now, Christians, and I'm talking to Christians here, I'll talk to non-Christians here in a minute, but Christians, let me ask you a question, and I don't want you to answer it out loud, but I want you to think about it. What do you think your biggest sin is? What do you think your besetting sin is? What causes you shame when you think of it? What addiction are you caught in? Some of us, it comes to us like that. Some of us, we're still thinking. What if that is not actually your greatest sin? What if that is not the sin that you are caught in because you're aware of it? C.S. Lewis says that when it comes time to confess our sins, many of us run to the things that are most obvious to us: binge eating, laziness. At the university, I often have young men come into my office who have raging hormones, and they think their biggest sin is related to sex. I remember one young man said, you mean there's seven deadly sins? What are the other six? But I like what C.S. Lewis said, where he says, the sins of the flesh are like flea bites compared to the sins that we are caught in and we're unaware of. When we're aware of our sin, there's something we can do about it. When we aren't aware, when we're like those sleeping people and oxygen is going to be gone, we don't even know the danger that we're in. And Paul says here, we must help each other when somebody is caught in sin. Now, first, I want you to note here, Paul doesn't say that he wants us to become the spiritual police, where we go around pointing out every sin that we see. Remember that love covers over a multitude of sin. There is nothing that will more quickly kill a relationship or a church than a critical spirit. And it's particularly dangerous for those of us that love theology. We are often aware when we get up to preach that there are people out there, and what they're waiting to hear is a mistake that we make when we speak. Or when they read a book, they read it to see the errors. You know what it's like to be in a room where you're constantly being judged? It's horrible. It's absolutely horrible to be in a room where you're constantly judged. And Paul's not talking about us going around trying to uncover, point out sins to everything. He's talking here about somebody who is caught in a repeated sin, something that is ongoing and you're unaware of. And I'll get back to this in just a minute. But I want to ask you a question. Are you in a relationship like that, where somebody can know you so well that they say, you're caught here and I want to help you? I talked to you married couples for a few minutes. Do you have a marriage such that you ask your spouse occasionally, tell me what you see that I can't? Do you have that kind of love? Tell me what you see that's going on in my life, because I'm blinded. I can't see. Also, helping somebody caught in a sin is largely done between brothers and sisters in Christ. Paul's not telling us that we do this to non-Christians. If you do this to a non-Christian, if you go to a non-Christian and say, hey, you're caught in the sin, you may not know it, but let me tell you, they're going to get this idea that Christianity is a basic set of rules that we have to follow. You have to follow these commands. Certainly one of my heroes is Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, a Welsh preacher in the 20th century. Listen to what Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones talks about to us Christians, how we should deal with non-Christians. And if you're a non-Christian, please listen to these words. Christianity, he writes, is primarily not a teaching. It is not a philosophy. It is not even a way of life. It is, before everything else, a relationship to a person. The New Testament, in a sense, will not even discuss with us the kind of life we are going to live until we have come to a satisfactory answer about Him, about Jesus. All along, the Bible shuts us down to this one matter and holds us up against this one thing. It refuses to even discuss our questions, our problems, or how to live until we answer the question, what have you made of Jesus? If you're not a Christian, you don't begin by saying, well, will I have to give this up? Will I have to live this way? Do I have to stop doing this? Do I have to start doing that? Do I have to go to church on Sundays? If you're asking those questions, you've been misled about what Christianity is. Christianity means that there's an absolute new center of your solar system, that you have a new king, a gracious king, but life is about him, not about you. What he says is an abundant life. If you look at verse 1 again, there's also a misleading phrase where Paul says, those of you who live by the Spirit. If you have a King James or an ESV, English Standard Version, I think it's translated better there, where it says, those of you who are spiritual need to help those that are caught in sin. And when you read that, you're like, oh man, I'm off the hook, because I've only been a Christian for 1 year or 17 years, and I'm not one of those spiritual people. Actually, what Paul means here when he talks about those of you who are spiritual or who live by the Spirit, that's another word for saying every single Christian, because every Christian has the Spirit of Christ living in them. If you're a new Christian, it's the Spirit that helps us in every area of life. If you've been a Christian for 70 years, it's the Spirit in us. You remember that phrase by the great writer of Amazing Grace, John Newton? When this poor lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave. That's us, isn't it, oftentimes? Even in our prayers, we're lisping and we're stammering. I have students who come to my office who want to talk about the gospel to their fellow students, and they say, but Dr. Woods, I don't know the right words. I haven't been to seminary. I don't know the right words to say. I have a lisping and stammering tongue, and I want to tell them, when you open your mouth and tell the gospel, all the power of the Godhead is behind your words. Because the Spirit of Christ is in us. See how we are supposed to help those who are caught in sin. He says to do this gently. And I like what it says in verse number 3. If you think that you're better than these people, you think that you're something, then Paul says, actually, you're nothing if you think that you're better than somebody else. You go to somebody and perhaps they're caught in a sin of not treating their spouse properly. You don't go to them and say, well, look at me. Look at how I treat my spouse. No, we don't do that. None of us husbands love our wives like Christ loves the church. You don't go to somebody and say, let me tell you about your blind spot because I don't have any. You know, people can smell arrogance 100 miles away. They can smell anger and non-graciousness. I also want you to know that Paul isn't ending Galatians chapter 6 by saying, here's a suggestion for you. This is a command. This is a command that we are supposed to do. But there are some things in our culture that I think makes it harder for all saints, for the modern church, to obey this command than it was for those who originally got this letter. Because the Galatian Christians lived what I would call very, very thick lives. What I mean is that their houses, if you look at the archaeology, their houses were right next to each other. They were almost like in a walled compound. They were always together. They were always working together. Their houses were abutted to each other. They really couldn't hide. They could look at somebody and they could see, you know, this person is caught in sin because I work with him every day. I see her every day, and she doesn't know it. They were what I would call interdependent, which is exactly what we try to avoid in this country and in the West. The very foundation of our country is independence. And we are never going to obey Galatians chapter 6, verse 1, until we become interdependent. Is anything wrong with loving independence? No, I'd rather live in this country than any other country in the world. But I think our idea of independence can seep into the Christian life and it becomes an idol. When Paul says in verse 1, you should restore him, that word restore is a medical term. It's a term that is used to take a dislocated bone and put it back in place. We often think that sin in our lives is like a bullet that comes from outside of us or like a splinter. But what Paul is saying here when he says that it's like a bone out of joint is that it is something inside of us. It is something that is perhaps really good, but it has become something that is out of kilter in our lives. Something good that has taken the place of the centrality of Jesus and the gospel in our lives. Economic security, our family, our job, our children. Matt Chandler, somebody who I really enjoy listening to, a Southern Baptist preacher in Dallas, said, and he had a church of like 10,000 people, and he's made all the churches go independent, so he now just has a couple thousand, I believe. But he said that the few the Pew Trust has come out with this statistic after 15 months of COVID in the evangelical church. Over the last 15 months, 1/3 of Christians who were attending church are no longer attending church. 1/3 of the Christians left their church because they went to a church not for theological reasons, but for ideological reasons. And 1/3 of the church has hunkered down and said, we are going to be here. You know, if Jesus Christ, when he came here, the right hated him and the left hated him. And if he would come back today, the left would hate him and the right would hate him. And what Paul is saying is what binds us together isn't an ideology. It's not this love of independence. It's this interdependence with Jesus Christ in the middle of all things. But oftentimes the Christian life is, you live your life, I'll live mine. Maybe I'll see you once every month or so when I come to church. Rather than committing to each other to live thick lives, to be in each other's life, to bear each other's burden. From the earliest days of the Christian church, it was said that no one has God as his or her father who does not have the church as his mother. That sure doesn't sound like 21st century evangelicalism. And I love Sunday mornings. I don't know how some people make it by coming every once in a while to church, because I need the sacrament every Sunday morning. I need you every Sunday morning. And there's a convergence that's taking place. I know that you see four walls here in this beautiful gym and you have a ceiling. We're actually in the presence of Christ right now. But we're not called to be lone rangers and come on Sunday morning and then that's it. The rest of the week, we're independent Christians. We're to practice what we might call radical hospitality. And that's what will change this society. That's what will change our culture that is in love with independence. Three very quick experiences. Stick with me here. Just let me tell you a few things that changed our lives. Because of my job, I've had to move every once in a while. And some of you have heard this story. One of the places I had to move, it was really hard to do, but I had to move to Hawaii. And we were at the University of Hawaii for a while. And the first Sunday that we were at this church, and it wasn't a Presbyterian church, so that might give you a clue. Five people came up to us and said, do you want to join us for lunch? We see that you're visiting here. You want to join us for lunch? And we took the first invitation that we had, and we went to this single woman's apartment. This was in Oahu, where UH was at. She said, I'm sorry, I don't have enough chairs. Do you mind sitting on the floor while we have lunch together? And I was like, here's somebody who just loves Christ so much that she doesn't have to have this huge spread for us or even chairs. And we tried to keep telling these people at Honolulu Bible Church, we kept trying to tell them, look, we are only going to be here for a couple of months. There wasn't a Sunday that went by that they didn't say, come on over to our house. Be part of our lives. And then about 15 years later, I worked for a year for the University of Indiana. And we went to Indianapolis, and I had to go before Karen. And Karen, knowing me, said, now, Shelton, don't go to one church and say, this is the church. I want you, let's look around at different churches. And I said, okay. And so I went to, of course, a sister church, a PCA church, Redeemer Presbyterian. Jason Dorsey, who's now in our Presbytery, a pastor here, was the pastor of Redeemer. It was a pretty large church. But by that time, I had been an elder almost 15 or 20 years, and I wanted to go to a church, and I wanted to sit on the back row, and I wanted to go and get filled up and leave for 1 year. Please, just 1 year. I walked through the door, and somebody says, "Who are you?" And I say, "Well, I'm Shelton Woods. I'm working kind of as a vice president for University of Indiana." "Oh, you are. Let me connect you with this person." And then this person connects me with this person. Before I know it, I'm eating lunch with somebody that day. I called Karen on the telephone that afternoon. I said, "I found the church." She said, "I knew you'd do that." But she went to that church just one Sunday, and she said, "This is it. They're practicing radical hospitality here. They want you in their lives." And again, we kept telling them, "I'm only here for a year." It didn't matter to them. And then here at All Saints, I'm part of two community groups. I have my brother and sister, John and Marcille, back there, who open their homes to us every month. And we go after Sunday and we have a meal with brothers and sisters. And that's very helpful to help share each other's burdens. But then there's this other thing. For more than 8 years, there are five men who have met, six of us all together, we have met every Tuesday morning at 6 o'clock in the morning for the last 8 years, all but just a handful of Tuesdays. And we don't meet and read Calvin's Institutes or another Bible study on the book of James. For 8 years, we have met every Tuesday morning with the guarantee that we are completely transparent with each other. That there's nothing that's going to come out at the university about me or in the newspapers that they don't already know. Where we share each other's sorrows. Where we cry together and laugh together. And then after about 40, 45 minutes, each of us pray together for each other. That allows us to see who's caught in a sin and they don't know it. You can't get to that without that. Is there sacrifice? Yeah. Waking up at 4:30 every Tuesday morning for 8 years, not being able to go into work when I want to go into work early to get stuff done, but that has changed my life. And some of those men are in this room and they have changed my life. If we want to obey Galatians chapter 6, verse 1, are you going to get into a relationship like that? Are you willing to? That's what we're going to be talking about in terms of our community groups. Maybe we start with small steps. Maybe we start saying, "Well, maybe once a month I'll have somebody over to my house." And then there's this final thing here. If you begin to look and study God, you'll begin to understand how important this is of being interdependent, because that is what the Trinity is. The Trinity is interdependent. There's this beautiful dance that's going on. God the Father was not able to die on the cross. The Holy Spirit didn't die on the cross, but Jesus did. The Holy Spirit points to Jesus. God the Father sends Jesus. It's this beautiful dance of interdependence. And when God created the universe, you can look at those stories in the first three chapters of Genesis. Every time he made something, he said, "That's good. That's beautiful." The first time he said, "This is not good," is he said, "It is not good for man to be alone. It is not good for man to be completely independent." And then we ruined everything because we wanted to be independent. And we think of, oh, yes, and then the curses came. The curse came for the women that it was going to be very difficult for them to have children. And the curse for the men was that there were going to be thorns and so forth, and life was going to be hard. But I wonder if that was the greatest curse, because to me, this was the greatest curse. The greatest curse was God said, "You want to be independent? Go on. And I'm going to put an angel here. And you're not going to be able to get back to me. He's going to keep you out. You want to be independent? And for human history, every murder, every lie, every somebody that has stolen, the bitterness, the anger, the bad marriages, the divorces, whatever it is in all of human history has been because we said, I want to be independent. And here comes the good news. God said, I'm going to actually allow them to come back in. But I can't do that without somebody paying the ultimate price. And I'm going to send my one and only son. And they're going to spit at him. They're going to pull his beard out. They're going to laugh at him. They're going to put him on a tree. But he's going to be the one that will make us once again interdependent. We seek, as Christians here at All Saints, deep, thick relationships where we come together and we stay with each other through thick and thin, where we come together and we grow old together. But there's one burden that you cannot bear. There's one burden that you can't bear for somebody who is caught in sin, and that is the burden of being reconciled to God. And thank God that burden has already been taken on the cross by Jesus Christ. And so when I get to with my brothers every Tuesday morning and we cry over what's going on in our lives, our children, or whatever it is, we know I cannot bear the weight of your sin, but I can point to somebody who can. And I can pray to you because he can. And who is this person? Paul writes about him in just a couple of books over in Colossians, that he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Amen. Let us pray. Our great God and Heavenly Father, we do look beyond these four walls and this ceiling to know that we are in your presence and that you call us as Christians to be in each other's lives so that we can see when somebody is asleep in the light who thinks everything's okay, but they're absolutely caught. Help us here at All Saints to be those that are radically hospitable, that we don't want anything back. We don't need reciprocity because we are doing only what you have done in laying down your life for us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We are going to be singing our next hymn. You can remain seated. Thank you.
Thank you, Shelton, for opening God's word to us today. During worship, we talk to God in prayer, we hear from God through his preached word, and we celebrate God together in the communion. The Lord's Supper is the family meal of Christians. If you're a baptized believer and you've placed your faith and trust in Jesus alone as your Savior, this is a meal for you. A few thoughts came to me during the sermon this morning. One is that this is possibly the best presentation or representation of radical hospitality that we have, and that is a remembrance of the way Jesus practiced radical hospitality. The man he loved the most. On the night he knew he was going to be crucified, he could have spent it alone, giving himself a pity party, but rather than that, he spent it with the 11 men he had poured his life into for 3 straight years. That's our Jesus, a man of radical, beautiful hospitality. So maybe this morning, imagine, more than imagine, believe that he's sitting next to you, that he's standing next to me here. He said, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you. And as we're gathered here today, so is he. Lord, be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Please pray with me. Loving Lord Jesus, I come before you now, and I confess, and we confess that you alone are the living God. You alone are worthy of all honor and praise, for you set aside your heavenly glory and came into this world as a man to redeem lost sinners from the curse of the law. And we praise you that we are included in your gracious forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, that you willingly offered up your body to be the sacrifice for our sin. Thank you that your body was broken for us and that your precious blood was shed to pay the full price for all our many sins. And not for us only, but for all who would trust in your precious name. Lord, we come before you in humble submission as we partake of the bread and the wine, and we do this in remembrance of you. Amen. We read in Scripture that on the night he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat. In the same way, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, shed for many for the remission of sin. Drink ye all of it. Please stand.
And the grace of Christ the risen Son, and
One announcement after the service, and again, thank you so much to all the Christian formation teachers who finally came forward after several weeks of asking. We're thankful. Please meet with me and Angela back by the nursery after the service. Kate Stelman's going to give us a tour of potentially the new rooms for Christian formation. And so we'll meet you there, and you can get your teaching materials to prepare for September 12th. Thank you. Now, receive this benediction from the Lord. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. May the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one and another and for all. Amen.